Hey everybody! Yeah, I'm much earlier than I've been lately, so give me my kudos for that. But anyways, I am here to do my review, give you my take of The Haves and the Have-Nots. This is Season 5, Episode 20, titled Smitten. And that title alone let me know that somebody was going to get bit by the love bug, okay? But before we get deep into it, I want to say, I hope everybody had a great holiday yesterday, day off work, hopefully. I sure did. If this is your first time to my channel, please click that subscribe button. I promise to give you great commentary on some of your favorite shows, just like this one. And if you're a returning subscriber, thank you so much. Now, yeah, I have to get into this episode because this episode was so good. Like, I was like, there was so much meaning and emotion behind this episode. I loved every second of it, okay? So let's just dig right on in. Okay, so the episode starts off with the slap heard around the world, okay? And if you was outside peeping in the window, you would have seen that mug too, because Veronica flew, okay? Flew clear across the room. Bam. At this point, RK is like, hey, yo, man, what the heck is your problem? Like, what are you doing? And steps in front, like, steps up to David. David is like, get out of my face. Like, very stone cold. Like, little boy, I'm not playing with you, okay? So then RK is like, you better get up out of here. And I'm thinking, RK, is this your house? Like, this is grown people's business, so you probably just need to pipe down, okay? And then so David is straight up like, move me. So RK is like, oh, you think I won't? David says, you can't. And I said, oh, David, I'm loving this. David is pissed off, okay? So then at this point, we see Veronica. She is laying on the floor. She is stunned, okay? Like, shocked. Clearly, this is the first time David has ever put hands on her, okay? Now, mind you, before he even put hands on her, she was calling him a simple B, a simple B, a simple B. Like, slapping him in his chest and everything. Like, and I'm like, oh, so you can put your hands on him and you didn't expect to, like, drive him crazy enough to do it back to you? Like, everybody should have kept their hands to themselves. But she didn't do that. And this is what has happened. So she is shocked. She looks at David and was like, you hit me. Like, you actually hit me. So David is like, well, you better be glad that's all I did. And she was like, oh, you SOB, okay? She was mad, okay? So then David once again is like, leave my son alone. So Veronica says, I'm coming after your son more now than I ever have, okay? Harder than I ever have. And I'm thinking, Veronica speaks of Jeffrey as if he's not her son. And this has always confused me, this dynamic with Veronica and Jeffrey, because Veronica, like, you birthed this human being. And it feels like David, like, has that, like, motherly connection with him that you're supposed to have with him, and you don't. So the fact that she's like, yeah, I'm coming after your son harder than ever, it really feels like Jeffrey is no longer Veronica's. Like, she's disowned him completely because he doesn't live the life that she would like for him to live. But whatever, I'll get into that again later. So she, at this point, still shocked. She's like, you really hit me. And David, at this point, all his emotions start really coming out, okay? He's yelling, but it's like a shiver, like a shake in his voice. Like, he's extremely emotional. So he says, after all I've done for you, after all the sacrifices I've made for you, and then Veronica cuts him off and says, you and that bee, speaking of Erica, better watch out in my house. So David says, yes, it was supposed to be your house. Actually, I bought the house for you when you attempted, well, when you did burn our house down to the ground. And I said, David, hold on, pause a second. David, I mean, you gotta be like some kin to Benny Young, okay? Because nobody else on the show is that stupid. This woman burnt your house down to the ground with you in it, okay? The purpose of her burning it down was so that you could burn to a crisp. And you went out and said, oh, she burned our house. I should go buy her her dream house, okay? That'll fix all the problems in our marriage. Like, David, you're just dumb, okay? Like, you're smart, but you're stupid at the same time, okay? Whatever. So David was like, I was a fool to stand by you and keep loving you. And I said, well, you know what? Why do fools fall in love? Okay. Because you a fool falling in love again for Erica. Okay. So anyway, I guess love is blind, and it's truly blind on this show. And he keeps screaming at her like, you made my life hell. And I felt that. I said, oh, this is the best this actor has ever done on this show. And so RK steps in and he straight up points to the door and was like, go. I said, RK, chill out. Okay. This your parents are speaking right now. Okay. Go sit in the corner. You are a third wheel in this equation. You're not even supposed to be talking. Clearly, they're airing out their, like, feelings, okay? They need to get this off their chest. Don't stop this moment, okay? So then David says exactly what I wanted to say, okay? He gets right in his face and was like, boy, mind your business. This don't have nothing to do with you. Okay, so then Veronica, she steps in front of her man boy, RK, and was like, it's okay. I got this. I'm going to show you just how bad this can get. So David, he's not scared. David was like, shoot your best shot. And I said, oh, David, you should watch your words, okay? Because she said, well, you know, as a matter of fact, it's funny you use that specific verbiage. I will do just that, literally. I will shoot my best shot. And I said, David, Veronica about to turn into a sniper, okay? Like, she about to be lurking out in the bushes. Like, you need, like, I don't know. Like, you need to wear a bulletproof vest because, David, now I feel like you and Erica are going to die by the end of the season. And Erica's going to die first because Veronica's going to want to see you suffer. Whatever. Maybe the last episode, one of them will die and it'll be by Veronica. But whatever. So then Veronica says, when we got married, I had two rules. Okay. And then she proceeds to say what the rules are. The one rule number one, that you would never cheat on me. And rule number two was that you would never put a hand on me. And you have done both. So I'm like, hold on, Veronica. Now let's not be the pot calling the kettle black. Okay. Because your dirt been coming out all season, okay? Like, you cheated on him with Benny Young, which he brought up. You cheated on him with Catherine's father. You cheated on him with Derek. You cheated on him with some other random judge. Like, just because you were doing it for, like, jobs or whatever to your benefit, like, you still cheated on him. So you should have required the same thing you required from him. You should have given him that same in respect, you know, that same honor in respect to your marriage, but you didn't. So girl, shut up. And you put your hands on him. You tried to burn him to the ground. Shut up. Okay. So David says, I never cheated on you. She said, yes, you did. He said, no, I gave up on you after you were on the front page of the newspaper in my car with Benny Young. And I said, well, you know, touche. Okay. Checkmate. Like, she got you there. I mean, he got you there. And then, so David is like, are you crazy? She said, you don't know what cheating is. He said, well, I guess I don't. But you know what? You are insane. Don't go near my son. Don't go near Erica. Okay. That's my boo. And stay out of my life. And walks out the house. And I said, oh man, you didn't crush Veronica. Okay. Now she's literally standing there crying. And she tells RK to get out. And after he asks her if she's all right, and she just keeps singing a tune in her head, like, you will regret this. You will regret this. And I said, oh, that's how the crazy people start off in movies. Like, she about to go full on insane. Like, she gonna be worse than Melissa. Okay, so then she grabs her phone and she's talking to herself. She's like, he hit me. He really hit me. Okay, so then she calls Derek. Okay, because y'all remember Derek used to be associated with the streets. He got some hitters with him, right? So, but he's really not trying to be about that life. So he's like, Veronica, I'm not doing that. She's like, I don't think you understand the dynamic of our relationship. You don't tell me, though, okay? That's what you're going to learn right now. So what you're going to do is that you're going to send me over a list of your hitters or whoever, your criminal friends, and you're going to have it here by the morning, or else I will be calling your parole officer. I don't care if you deal with them or not. Have it at my house. Derek is like, whatever. They get off the phone. So then we have David, okay? David is just left Veronica's house mad. Now he's headed to his condo because remember, Jeffrey told him it had been ransacked. So he's shocked when he looks at all this stuff tore up. So David is asked Jeffrey if he's okay. And then he's like, your mother is a mess. And then Jeffrey was like, oh, wait, like, I know she a mess, but like, she didn't do this. And so David is like, okay, well, if she didn't do it, then who did do it? And Justin says, well, Jeffrey says, Officer Justin. Now you're referring to him as Officer Justin, like your daddy knows that's your boo. Okay. So David was like, that cop from the jail? Jeffrey says, yes. Okay. And so David goes a step further to say, was this before or after you slept with him? Jeffrey said, well, how do you know that? Like, you got cameras in here or something? He didn't really say that part, yeah. But David said, oh, well, your mother already told me about it. And so Jeffrey says, I already know what you're going to say. I should stop hanging around him and I should end it. And David says, well, I didn't know there was anything to end. I mean, you ain't never claimed them. I didn't ask you a million times. You always say you don't know what y'all are, okay? And so Jeffrey goes a step further to say, I like him. I really do. He just needs help. And I said, Jeffrey, this is a sad moment right now because that is what David was saying about Veronica for years. And the fact that Jeffrey is saying that he likes him and he needs help, but he needs help, is insane to me because Justin just tore up your daddy's apartment. He just held a gun to your head and his head at the same time. He's threatened you time and time again, and he tries to control your life. He makes you furious, and you still talking about you like him? Like, this is a fatal attraction. Like, somebody is gonna die. And it's just really sad because clearly Jeffrey has learned to take this type of, like, abuse that he confuses as love from his own father. But David doesn't really argue with him because he understands, because he's gone through that with Veronica. So whatever the case, David even says, well, your mother needs help too, but you see that she won't change. So you do know that this type of behavior does lead to bodily harm. Jeffrey says yes. So then David goes a step further to ask him if Justin has been physically or verbally abusive to him. And Jeffrey says yes to both questions. So David is like really furious at this point, but he even knows there's really nothing he can do about it. But he just asked him, like, didn't you learn this in school? And Jeffrey is like, yes, of course. But yeah, how often do we use stuff that we learn from school? Not when your heart is involved. Okay, so then Justin comes lurking in the shadows because, you know, all he does is stalk Jeffrey all day long. Like, I'm pretty sure he's gonna lose his job this season. So Justin says, I'm so sorry. And then David says, I didn't even know you were there. And then Jeffrey jumps in and says, oh, well, that makes two of us. Like, I thought you was gone. And then Justin is like, I'll pay for all of this, I promise. And David said, oh, so you gonna pay for this $6,000 couch and that $50,000 painting? And Justin was like, well, I ain't got the money like that. Like, I thought it was like $700 couch. Like, I can get the knockoff version. Yeah, he didn't say that, but that's what he was thinking in his head. But he was like, I'm gonna figure out how to pay for it some type of way. But I will, like, I'm really sorry about this. So David says, you know what? I recognize that Jeffrey is an adult. And if he chooses to be involved with you, there isn't much that I can do about it. But you do need to get some help. And Justin agrees that, yeah, he will go and get help. And then David warns him that he's much worse than Veronica is. So you've met Veronica. Just know, like, don't hurt him or you're going to have to deal with me. And then David asks Jeffrey, is this what you want? Like, do you want this relationship with him? Jeffrey is still like, I don't know what I want. Okay. But at this point, David is so furious, like, looking at his apartment and looking at the situation that his son is in, that he really is, like, sick to his stomach and he would like to put hands on Justin, but that's not gonna make matters any better. So he just leaves. Okay, so then Justin is excited to tell Jeffrey that he's willing to talk to a psychologist, and if he talks to a psychologist, will Jeffrey move in with him to their place? And Jeffrey is like, you need to just focus on getting better, okay? You need to get help. Okay, So then we see the owner of the bar is down to the police station, and he's giving a description of who he thinks is responsible for stabbing the Malone. Or shooting. I think it's stabbing. Yes, stabbing. And while he's in critical condition. So at this point, you can tell that he's giving the description of Benny because he doesn't know anybody else that was there. Luckily, there are officers, and they are actually in the DA, and they're looking at camera footage from outside of the bar. They see Jim Cryer and Wyatt Cryer walk out of the bar and trying to figure out why they were there. At this point, you see Sarah in the background, the assistant to the DA. She's looking kind of nervous because Jim is deeper into this thing than he realizes. So then they also fast forward the tape and they see Benny walking out of the bar as well. And they put two and two together. That's Benny Young. All three of them have history with each other. Wyatt actually ran Benny Young over and his parents covered it up. Like, it's a tangled web. And so they want to bring like Benny Young in to question him since he was the last one. And that is the one that the owner is identifying as being responsible for this whole ordeal. Okay, so then we have Sarah. She like breaks away from them, goes to this older officer in the jail, kind of like flirts with him a little bit. You can tell that he got like a little thing for her, at least a crush. So she uses that to her advantage, and she asks to be let into the evidence room really quick. She knows nobody's supposed to know, so she'll do it quickly. So she goes in there, she looks through a few file boxes, she takes the bullets from the case the DA being shot. Is it the DA being shot? Somebody being shot. Well, the bullets in the case, and I believe, yeah, it's the DA. Also, the same bullets connected to Amanda's death. She takes those bullets, puts it in her purse because Jim told her to get rid of it. And then she just disappears and walks out with a smile on her face and basically gets away with it. Nobody will ever know that she's in there. Okay, so then we have Hannah. Hannah is at home and she's in the kitchen. Hannah calls Catherine because that's like, you know, they sister friends, okay? And she asks her, Catherine, if she called the attorney. Catherine says yes, she called Marty. And Hannah wants to know how much the attorney will cost. And Catherine says, don't worry about it, you can afford it. Well, Hannah was like, I can only afford it if it's free. It must be free then. And then Catherine is like, don't trip, you can afford it, just call him. And Hannah's like, okay. And I'm thinking like, okay, clearly Catherine is going to pay for it, or she already paid for it, because Catherine funds Hannah's whole life, okay? So Hannah then gets off the phone and was like, this woman is crazy, okay? She's talking to herself, this woman is crazy. I only got $32 in my account. I cannot afford this this man, but okay. So this is totally unrealistic, and this can only happen in Tyler Perry land, okay? So Hannah gets her computer, her laptop computer, opens up the laptop computer, and look what it is, her online banking. Yeah, she is already signed in, okay? And I'm thinking, no, for security purposes, when you close your laptop, you're gonna be logged out of your online banking, okay? If only it was that simple and I didn't have to sit there and try to think of what my password was to log in. Okay, but yeah, that's beyond the point. So flips up the laptop. She is like looking twice, like, dang, like something wrong with my eyes. She sees over $8 million in her account, and she automatically assumes that her good sister friend Catherine just loves her that much that she would dump $8 million in her account. And I'm like, girl, Catherine have been generous, but she ain't gonna be that generous, okay? So she calls Catherine. Coincidentally, Catherine doesn't pick up the phone, so it really makes it look like Catherine is like avoiding her call because she did do that. And she leaves a message and tells her, like, I can't accept this money. Please call me back. Whatever. So then we see Wyatt. He's still in the psych ward. He's still, like, strapped up, like, in his straight coat. He's more calm now than he was the day before because clearly, like, some of the drugs are wearing off. So Jeffrey, being the good friend that he is, he goes to check on him. Wyatt is extremely irritated at this point from being restrained all night long. He does think that it's illegal for him to be held against his own will, but then Jeffrey informs him, like, it's not illegal because you were threatening to harm yourself. So at this point, like, they're allowed to keep you in here under, like, suicide watch, basically, for so many days. And he tells him that, well, Jeffrey finds out that Catherine hasn't made it up there yet, but he does know that she will be up there to see her son. So Wyatt thinks that, like, he says, like, they're going to kill me and it's going to be on your hands. And Jeffrey is like, okay, you ain't going to play the guilt trip with me. And I'm thinking, okay, Wyatt, are, when you're saying they're going to kill me, are you referring to the Malones? Because you saw the person that you thought you killed being wheeled to the hospital? Or are you referring to, like, the people that are over the psych ward because you're paranoid? I'm not sure. We'll find out, I suppose. So Wyatt makes Jeffrey leave, and Jeffrey don't even argue with him, okay? So then we have Sarah. Sarah calls Jim to update Jim and let him know that she has gotten the bullets out of the evidence room and their business with each other is done. And so he's like, Jim is like, well, wait, how do I know that everything is done? Sarah said, I'm getting rid of it. And Jim is like, nah, bruh. Like, I want proof, okay? She says, you'll get proof when you see that the case has been dropped. He was like, that's not good enough. I need you to bring it to me. I want it in my hands. Like, that's the only way I'll have proof and feel secure in this. And make sure don't nobody follow you. She really didn't want to, but she just said, okay, fine. Because she thinks this is the last time she'll deal with Jim Cryer. Okay. So then we have Derek, okay? Derek, despite what he wanted to do or didn't want to do, he still shows up to Veronica's house because he knows that she's like cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs crazy, okay? He shows up, gives her this list of hitters, and he was like, look, don't call me with this, like, ever again. And then Veronica is like, when I call you, I don't care what you're doing, okay? Like, you drop everything and you come, or I will call your parole officer. And then so Derek tells her, Derek is like real tough. Like, I'm not playing this game with you no more. Like, some things are worth going to jail for. And Veronica is like, you owe me and I always collect. And so Derek is like, look, I'm living life on the straight and narrow path. Okay. My road is clean at this point. So if you ever call me again and ask me to dig back into my past life, then I promise you, like, you need to consider this a threat, okay? You will regret it. And so she's like, ooh, I'm so scared, like, playing him off. And he was like, well, you should be, like, with a straight face. Like, I don't know what type of shade you're throwing or idle threats, but this is a real threat. I kind of like that side of Derek, y'all. So Veronica is like, well, I can't wait to need something else. Derek is like, looks at her like, girl, don't play with me. And he leaves. Okay. So then we have Hannah and Benny. So Benny asked Hannah, like, aren't you supposed to be at work? And she was like, you know, I'm not going to work at a time like this. And then so Benny says, I'll be fine. And she says, I know you'll be fine because I'm getting you a lawyer. So Benny tells her, like, we can't afford that. And Hannah says, yes, we can afford it. Okay. So at this point, she's still assuming that that money was from Catherine, when in all actuality, it's the money that's from Candace that Candace had transferred to Benny's account, but she just didn't tell him the amount. But we know that it was $8 million. Okay, so she is calling Catherine on the phone because she wants to, like, know, like, about this money. Catherine is, like, lost. Like, I have no idea, like, what you're talking about. Like, I didn't put any money in your account, but I have an idea of where it came from. At this point, she's like, Catherine is putting two and two together in her head, like, oh, if it's connected to Candace, then Candace probably like scammed somebody and she got the money sent to her and then sent to her brother's account. But Hannah and Benny's account are connected because they have joint accounts. So Catherine doesn't want to talk about it over the phone, but she's like, I'll let you know, like, in person. So at this point, Benny is figuring it out in his head too. So he tells his mother to, like, hang up the phone, and she's like, what? So he pulls out his phone and he proceeds to call Candace. And then Hannah is like, no, it might be a mistake. It might be a mistake. Like, I'm going to call the bank and get it corrected because I'm not trying to go to jail. So then Benny is like, it isn't a mistake. And then once Hannah hears Candace's name said over the phone, then she's like, starts going in. Like, Benny, are you serious? This is from your sister. You know this is a scam. Da 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 da. Candace is like, why would you tell her? Benny said, I had no choice. Like, we're on a joint account together. She said, well, why didn't you tell me that? He said, you didn't ask. Girl, you know you gotta ask Benny all the questions because your brother is not the sharpest tool in the shed. But anyway, she says, don't be alarmed. We're gonna have to move the money. I'm on my way over there now. Okay. So then we have Charles, aka Great Value Obama. Okay. So he is practicing his speech in front of Landon and clearly someone else that works like on his like election team. So like Landon helps him with his tie or something like that, helps Great Value Obama, and then he walks out. So the guy is still in there and he warns Charles that he needs to be careful. Charles is like, be careful of what? He was like, Landon, I mean, people starting to talk, like, I'm just saying, like, he be spending late nights in your room. The staff is starting to get like concerned, and he's like, what are you talking about? Like, he's just a really nice guy. The dude is like, no, he's gay and he wants you. And Charles is like, what? Like, my radar didn't go off for that. Like, now I feel stupid because I talk to him about women all the time. I think you're wrong. I don't think he's gay. And the dude is like, trust me, he is, and he wants you. And people are starting to talk, and, you know, like, your reputation. And Charles is like, I don't want to talk about this anymore, okay? He is a nice young man. He is going to be professional. We're two grown men. Like, you think I'm just going to let him try me? Like, no, it's fine. Like, I don't even care about that, okay? And all the whispers need to come to a close. So then the guy says, well, Landon, he's territorial. And Great Value Obama is like, dude, this conversation is over, okay? So then Landon comes back in the room. Great Value Obama kind of acted a little weird. Like, Landon kind of sensed that some conversation was had. But then they just go on about their day. Okay, so then we got Erica, okay, Eazy-E, okay. So we got Eazy-E, Erica, and she is in the bathroom. Y'all, I thought this was a pregnancy test. I was like, oh, this girl is going all the way. She's in love. But at this point, we figure out it's an ovulation test. How do we figure this out? She calls Rocky, okay? Rocky informed her that he was in the hospital. So Erica tells Rocky, like, she needs his help with something. She wants him to apologize with Candace. Basically being that she needs, like, an insider, somebody on the inside to know Candace's every move and what she's doing so that Rocky can update Erica. Because at this point, Erica is going all the way with this, okay? She's ovulating right now. She's trying to get pregnant. Like, she's trying to secure her lifestyle. Because even if her and David don't work out, David got money over money. And she just want to get paid. And I'm thinking, like, do you see how much he loves, like, Jeffrey? And Jeffrey is, like, a super grown baby, okay? Yeah. If Erica ended up having a baby by David, David would make sure he had that baby, okay? And he got the money and the attorneys, and he will just, like, set her up and make her look crazy. Just like Veronica is doing with Melissa. But whatever the case, so she gets off the phone. So then we have David. David is speeding in his car, parks at Jim's house, rushes in. He's super hype, okay? David is like, I need you to talk me down. I need you to talk me down. Jim is like, what is it about? He said, Veronica. And then so Jim is like, well, maybe I need to talk you up. And David was like, I am so mad. And so Jim says, what happened? David was like, she made me come out of myself. She made me come out of myself. I had to pimp slap that beat. And I'm like, what? Like, David, like, you don't even talk like that. Like, what is this? So at this point, Jim is dying laughing. Like, you did what? Like, and David is like, don't laugh because I feel terrible. I feel bad. And then so Jim is thinking the same thing we thinking. Like, you feel bad? Like, don't you remember this woman tried to burn you alive in a house, in y'all house? And he was like, yeah, I know, but I still feel terrible. And then so Jim is like, now let me ask you, how much force comes with, like, pimp slapping somebody? And so David is like, well, shoot, she flew across the room. And so Jim is still dying laughing. And then Jim is like, dang, you gave her some wings. And I'm like, Jim, you are, like, loving this, right? So then he's like, that's a lot of rage for you because you don't get like that. And then Jim says, well, you should have let me take her out when I had the chance. Like, Jim was going to set her up to die. And then David is like, no. At this point, I just don't know what I'm going to do with her. And so Jim tells him what we're all thinking. Like, you know Veronica's going to retaliate. He was like, yeah, and I'm afraid she'll go after Erica. And so Jim is like, ah, you've been bit by the love bug. Like, you're smitten with this girl, aren't you? And then David admits, like, you know, I am. But don't worry about it. Oscar already checked her out. Like, there's nothing in her background. And he was like, Oscar, okay. Because that's the dude that still needs to give me my money back. And he better give me my money, okay? I need my money on time. Run me my money, okay? So then we have Sarah pulling up outside, okay? So at this point, Jim tells him to, like, get lost, okay? That he don't need to know about the Sarah thing, just in case they end up in court one day, okay? What is it? Plausible deniability. You don't know nothing, you ain't seen nothing, okay? So Sarah comes inside. He says, he refers to Sarah as his get out of jail free card, right? So she brought the bullets to Jim, and she's like, okay, so we're done. Jim was like, well, actually, I got one more thing I want to show you upstairs. She was like, are you serious? Because this is your wife's house. He was like, okay, so Ann, like, did I ever care about her before? And she was like, no, I am done with this. We are done. And she says goodbye, and then she leaves. Jim is like, okay, whatever. So next thing you know, we have Candace, okay? Candace pulls up to Benny's house, okay? She need her money, right? So she comes in, she says hi. Benny ain't saying much. She says hi again. Then he finally says hello. And then she says, can I talk to you about it? At this same time, Hannah is walking into the room, okay? Benny says, no, but you can't answer my question. Where did you get that money? And then Candace was straight up with him. She was like, I blackmailed someone. He said, who? And then she said, and then Hannah, like, cuts them off and was like, I saw the pictures. I know you blackmailed Jim Cryer. Now you're probably blackmailing that man that's about to become president. Because she saw him on the news, like, talking about little Quincy. And so she was like, actually, I wasn't speaking to you. I was speaking to my brother. Thank you. But no, it is a very powerful man that I blackmailed. And no, I'm not going to tell you. And so Benny is like, Candace, like, you need to tell me. And then she was like, we can move the money to another account. Okay. And I promise you, I will give you $1 million just as, like, just to show, like good faith, like, I owe you for that tow yard, for the trucks, for the houses. I want to just give you $1 million of it. So Benny like, $1 million? Because that could really do us good right now. And she was like, yes, I promise you, I've gotten away with it. Like, we're good. I can give you $1 million. And he's like, no, you didn't get away with it because somebody is always after you, Candace. Like, I highly doubt you got away with it. With that kind of money, yeah, they're going to keep looking. That's $8 million. So then Hannah jumps in because she's super righteous, right? She was like, everything you do is going to come back around, okay? Like, and then Candace is like, here we go again. And Hannah says, yeah, here we go again because this is the type of mess that got your son killed, okay? She's trying to strike a nerve there, okay? So Candace is going to ignore her. She turns to Benny. She was like, Benny, I need that money. So then Hannah says, Benny, you take that money. We going to have a problem. Benny is like, but you know it's $1 million, though. Like, his whole, like, attitude changed. And then she's like, we are not taking that money. And then she's like, Benny, are you crazy? And then so Hannah holds up a picture of little Quincy, like, right in Candace's face. And Candace is literally, like, not looking at it, like, I'm not gonna let her get to me right now. And then Benny is like, Mom, like, we really need it, though. And then so Hannah says, oh, you gonna be a criminal, too? And then Candace is like, come on, like, looking at Benny, like, we gotta go. And then Hannah's like, well, why can't you look at your baby? And then Candace is still like, come on, Benny, let's go, because I'm trying to ignore her. I'm not speaking to her. And then Hannah is like, well, they ain't gonna let you walk out with the money anyway. So Candace says, why not? And she said, because it requires two signatures, okay? We're joint owners on the account. And then Benny is like, dang, like, she really is right. So Candace is like, dang it, like, what am I gonna do? Okay, so then Candace is like, ask her mother, like, why are you like this? And then Hannah is like, what? And she was like, so self-righteous. So then Candace turns to Benny and was like, I really need this. And Benny is like, I can't get it without her. And then Hannah is like, I know you don't think I'm gonna give it to her. And then Benny is like, it's hers. Hannah's like, girl, she blackmailed somebody. That's not her money. I'm gonna give it to the FBI because they're gonna be looking for it. And so Candace tells Benny, like, I need to get that money. I promise you. Then all of a sudden, Saved by the Bell, this argument doesn't go any further. It's a ding dong. Now, I don't know that they are Saved by the Bell because who is at the door is the police, okay? They come in, they put Benny in handcuffs, and they tell him he's under arrest. Now, they don't say you're under arrest for dot, dot, dot. So we don't know at this point what he's under arrest for. But remember earlier in the episode, they told him they were at the police station. They saw him on the cameras and they said they were bringing him in for questioning. So my other question is, okay, when y'all gonna question Jim Cryer and Wyatt Cryer? Because y'all know they low down and dirty and y'all already going after him anyway. Why you gotta bring in Benny first? But whatever the case, that is how this episode left off. Candace was confused. Benny was arrested and Hannah is like emotional at this point. So at this point, we already know Hannah and Candace, they don't have to work together because what they do have in common is their love for Benny. So we shall see how this goes. Y'all let me know y'all thoughts below. Please comment, like this video. And if you made it this far and you're not a subscriber, quit wasting your time and click that subscribe button. And I will see you guys on my next video. Bye.